The following program does not necessarily represent the views and opinions of Reality Radio 101, its advertisers and sponsors, or its listening audience. Listener discretion is advised. And welcome to this House of Musicians with your host, singer, songwriter, and founder of the band, Inner City Outlaws, the Baritone Bear, Barry Smith, right here on Reality Radio 101. To get on board right now, send us an email. Our email address is thishouseofmusicians@gmail.com. Now, right to your host of this House of Musicians, Barry Smith.
Hey, folks. Good evening, listener. Welcome to this House of Musicians radio show on Reality Radio 101. We hope you enjoy the next hour with us as we do our small part to help promote musicians, bands, and venues. Gary, the guest we have tonight that needs absolutely no promotion at all.
You know, I pulled out a new pen and a piece of paper, hoping to get Neil's autograph, but he's not here.
I'll tell you what, man, I'm absolutely stoked. How could we not be? Please welcome Neil Donell. Neil, how are you doing tonight?
I'm great, guys. How are you all doing?
We're good. We're good. Thank you.
We're doing a lot better since you're here. Neil, It's an honor to have you. I know Neil. Now, folks out there, Neil's Canadian singer who's worked extensively as a session musician, has been nominated for multiple Juno Awards, and he's a lead tenor vocalist for the classic rock band, Can You Believe This, Chicago. Neil, what an achievement, man. Let's start right from the beginning, when you were younger, how you were influenced by music and what music you were influenced by.
Well, that's a great question and a suitable jumping off point. I guess the very first band that I was influenced by was had to be the Beatles. You know, I might be dating myself a little bit here, but in the I was just a kid, a toddler, really. Mm-hmm. But you know, that was the first music that caught me. I remember you know, very vividly, sort of begging my parents to buy Beatles 45s, you know, when I was, I was a little kid. Mm-hmm. And, you know, just being totally enamored with that music. And that was the beginning of it for me. And, you know, then it sort of branched off into mostly British rock acts, you know, back then.
Sure. And were your parents listening to the Beatles? Is that how you got influenced, or was it your friends?
No, you know, it was mostly from the radio. I mean, you know, my father had his influence was really, I guess, you know, he listened to a lot of classical music, and you know, my mother liked more pop music. She was a big fan of Frank Sinatra and Dean Martin and people like mm-hmm. that. But there was always music in the house. You know, there was always something playing on the radio or the stereo. And when the Beatles came out, It got my attention, you know, literally when I was 3-4 years old. I keyed into it very quickly.
You and so many other artists I've had on the show say the same thing. It's always the Beatles. I guess they were the first biggest thing. Do you remember when you started singing?
Yes, I do. In fact, you know, I've been working sort of piecemeal on a memoir for the last year or so. And I was just writing the other day a chapter about, you know, titled Beginnings, oddly enough, you know.
Sure.
And it was about my first public performance, which was in grade one, in front of the class, Mrs. Muldoon. I remember her name.
Amazing.
She had me stand up in front of the class and sing "Twinkle Twinkle Little Star."
Wow!
Accompanying myself on the triangle, and that I remember it very vividly. Curiously enough, even this many years later, decades and decades later.
Good for you. That's such an amazing story. So now you're becoming a teenager. The first band you played in?
Well, it actually started kind of before then. You know, I was in elementary school in mm-hmm. Montreal, where I grew up. And they decided, it's a brand new school that had just been constructed. And they decided that they were going to have a choir in the school. And of course, you had to actually audition to get in the choir, because they needed to determine whether or not you could actually hear pitch. So I had to go, into a room with the music teacher in the school. I guess I was in grade four, maybe something like that. So probably, 9 or 10 years old. And they just took you to determine that you could hear pitch. And so they had about, I guess it was about a 40 voice choir in the school. And just me and one other boy, the rest were all girls.
Wow.
And that was the sort of, and I don't know why, I wanted to do that, why I felt compelled to do that, because there's no music anywhere in my family, in the background.
Wow.
Neither one of my parents were musical, or, I was never sort of pushed in that direction, or that was just never introduced to me. But for some reason, I felt like I needed to be in this choir. And then when I got into high school, I guess I was about 14, and I used to sing songs in the back of a friend's car. He would, one of the situations, I had buddies who were a couple years older than me, and one of them, we'd wait till the father fell asleep, and he'd steal the station wagon for a few hours,
Wow.
Yeah, back it out of the carport, and we'd go out for a little drive, and just kind of hang out, maybe go have a hamburger, and they put the radio on, and I would sing along with the songs, And one of the guys in the car, one of the buddies, said, "Well, there's a band in school, and they're looking for a guy to sing with the band. Why don't you try out?"
Wow.
And I went, "Nah," but I did, and sure enough, that was my first band. So I was about 14.
And the name of the band was? Do you remember?
Gosh, I don't remember. We only did one gig. We did a little gig in a chalet in a park one Friday at night. And I believe, I still remember what we each got paid. I think it was in the vicinity of about $4.60 or something like that.
Wow. That's awesome. And do you remember what songs you were playing?
Well, at that point we were doing, Black Sabbath and Cream.
Cool.
And some Zeppelin, and it was all pretty much all British rock stuff. There wasn't even any Beatles in the set. I just remember, sort of heavier British rock acts that we were covering.
Sure. And so now let's move ahead a little bit. So you played one gig with this band. What did you do after that?
Well, that band, didn't last long. And, there was a music program in the high school. So everybody started, people that were interested, they would get into the music class. It was an elective. It wasn't a mandatory subject you had to take. So I did. I played saxophone 1 year and trumpet 1 year. And a lot of other people I knew, that were sort of in the high school who were had interest in music, did the same thing. They'd go in. It was all woodwinds and horns predominantly, and maybe some percussion. And around that time is when Chicago emerged.
Right.
And so a bunch of us decided to form a band. And we tried to play, Chicago songs and Blood, Sweat, and Tears, a little Santana and stuff like that. So I've been, that's the strange part of things. I've been doing a lot of these Chicago songs, for a very, very long time. I've known this book pretty well.
Sure. And so was that Brass Transit then, what you're talking about, what you formed at that time?
No, no. This was a band. This was a band that we actually called Creation.
Okay.
And it was based in Montreal.
Yep.
And we were all, I mean, I think the oldest guy in the band was the bass player, and I think he was 19 or 20.
Wow.
And he wasn't in high school, but I mean, there were seven of us or eight of us in that band. And, you know, most of us were 15 or 16 years old. And the drummer was a little older and the bass player was a little bit older, and that was it. And we had an agent in Montreal who got us a few pretty good gigs, actually. And the one that I remember very well, we played at a place called the Chateau Montebello for a Liberal Party convention. And wow. I remember, you know, Justin's dad being there. He was the prime minister at the time.
Amazing.
Pierre was there. So, you know, after that, I went out east to the Maritime provinces and worked for a few years before I went to university. And then in university, I ended up in a band there to sort of help fund my education.
Amazing.
And that was another cover band as well. And then after that, I was back in Montreal and I started doing session work back in Montreal and working with a couple of local bands there. So that's,
that's how it
played out for me until I ended up, I landed in Toronto in around 1983, I think it was.
Yeah, you're talking about you were 16 and you're playing in this band, but you've had musical singing experience for 10 years already at the age of 16. It's so impressive to start that young. So now you're in Toronto. How do you hook up with, was there anything that came before Brass Transit when you were in Toronto? How did you manage to?
Yeah.
Let's talk about that for a moment.
Brass Transit was a lot of fun, and these are still friends of mine, and I'll get to that in a second, but when I came to Toronto, immediately, because I was kind of looking for work, I had been working as a lab technician in Montreal. I had a 9-to-5 job, mm-hmm. and I got laid off in the 80s. And, you know, I knew that the sort of the center for session work in Canada was Toronto. And I had some contacts in Toronto. So, you know, I packed my bags and I headed here. And, but I had to work, you know, I had to make a living. So
sure.
I got together with a local band here and immediately kind of went back on the road, a cover band that actually had some very good original material and they ultimately wanted to do, their own record. But, you know, the trials and tribulations of being on the road, you know, took its toll and we all ended up going our separate ways. And I ended up back in Toronto, about 2 years after I had moved here, and ended up working again at a full-time job that somebody arranged for me, really, because it was a very tough job market at that point. It was a recession going on.
Right.
And then I, because I had a couple of contacts, I started showing up at a very well-known venue in Toronto called the Blue Note Club. And the Blue Note Club was, a lot of famous R&B artists went through there in the 80s. And a lot of celebrities would show up, you know, actors and actresses and music personalities would show up in that club. And they had a thing where, you know, at the end of the second set, if there were singers in the audience, you could get up and you could, you know, do a verse of a song, you know, kind of a bit of a jam. Mm-hmm. And I went up there, you know, and so through that, my name started to circulate. You know, I was kind of the new guy in town. My name got around and eventually I got a guest spot in the club. I did that on two separate occasions. Mm-hmm. And this is an interesting story because on the second occasion, I was in there and I was doing, I think I had a Marvin Gaye tune in my set and I had a Toto tune in my set, I believe. And another song, you got what you did, like they had two guests up, you know, mm-hmm. In the second set and a male and a female, and you do three or four tunes and then everybody would get together for that last tune. That's where people from the, who were in the audience could get up and, you know, and sing a little bit.
Cool.
So there was a bit of a buzz going around the club that there was somebody, you know, very famous coming that was going to be in the club that night. And mm-hmm. I didn't know much about it. And, so I did my set, and, after my set, somebody motioned me to come over to their table. And it was a lady that I'd known from session work. And she said, somebody here wants to meet you.
Wow.
And I walked up to this table, and this gentleman was sitting there, very distinguished looking gentleman. And he introduced himself to me, and I didn't know who he was at the time.
Wow.
And I remember the first thing he said to me, he said, did you know that Toto was looking for a lead singer?
Mm-hmm.
And I said,
wow.
I said, no, I didn't. He said, yeah, they were. He said, they found somebody. He said, but had I known about you, I would have got you an audition with them.
Sure.
And before he said that, before he said anything else to me, he said, wow, you blew me away. and that man was David Foster.
Wow. How incredible is that?
Yeah. I didn't know him at the time. So after that, you know, my name began to circulate, get around, you know, in the session world. And I started, you know, working more and more. And, you know, flash forward, you know, to now, I have logged more than 10,000 recording sessions in my career. Yep. At this point, you know.
And that's incredible. That is so
yeah.
huge. And for David Foster to even compliment you is incredible. And it's all because of how great your voice is. It's as simple as that. People's names get out because of how great they can sing, your stage performance and whatnot, which is absolutely wonderful. So here you are. Let me stop for one sec. We got a couple of emails, Neil. This one's from Madden W. He says, hello, Barry. Hello, Neil. Wow. Thanks for having Neil on the show tonight. Love him. Love Chicago. Happy New Year to all of you. Thanks for the gifts of your songs, Neil. That's from Matt.
Oh, that's lovely. Thank you so much for writing in. That's very kind of you. I appreciate that very, very much.
Let's do one more. This one says, hey, Barry, welcome Neil to This House of Musicians. Neil and I have been, and of course, still are huge fans of Chicago. I saw them 7 times. I think I have everything they've ever recorded. Neil, I applaud you when they were looking to add to the band. They picked the right guy and you stepped in and never missed a beat. I had a chat about you just recently with friend of yours, Brian Gatto. I know I speak from all of us at Roller Coaster. Congratulations, Neil, on a job done, and keep up the good work. Like all of us, hope to see you out there gigging soon. That's Doug from the band Roller Coaster. Doug Robertson.
That's you know. Hey, thanks, Doug. That's great. I really do appreciate that. You know, every time when people reach out to me like that and say, you know, such kind things to me, I'm grateful.
Absolutely, it's so much worth living when you're, you know, respected as such a great performer and singer. Here's one more from Paula S. Paula says, hello from Washington, D.C. Love Neil, love Chicago. Happy New Year and stay safe. Thank you for that, Paula. Neil, why don't we play a song and then discuss that song when we're done playing it? How does that sound?
That would be great fun.
Awesome. Okay, folks, I have Neil Donell, amazing lead singer from the band Chicago, on the show tonight. I am still stoked and have goosebumps here talking to Neil. We're going to play one of his songs. This one's called Sing Your Song. And when we come back, we'll discuss that song. Here it is again, Neil Donell on This House of Musicians radio show right here on Reality Radio 101.
Song, sing it proud and sing it strong. Top of your voice, no shame, only passion. Find your key, and soon you will find the melody. You're flying free, higher than you have ever flown. Now you're there's no retreat. Your rock is self-belief. Precious gift, it's for this moment you live. Stand at the edge of the sky. Throw your head back, close your eyes. Sing your song. Fly straight and narrow. Your life is a narrow. Your aim is true. Walk through the dark. Follow your heart. Brave looks beautiful on you. Sing it proud, sing it strong. Ooh, sing a song. Top of your voice, baby. Yeah. Sing your song.
Hey, welcome back, folks. I have the one and only Neil Donell on the show tonight, lead tenor vocalist for the classic rock band Chicago. What a treat it is. Let's talk about, Neil, the song we just played, Sing Your Song.
Oh, yeah, I wanted to send that song to you, give you a little bit of insight into the, you know, the writing process, the creation of new material. This song was is essentially what you heard is a song kind of in its demo form. It's not been completed. It wasn't a full mix. Not all the instrumentation was there. It's probably, I'm going to say, if I have to quantify it, it might be sort of 2/3 of the way to being completed. Mm-hmm. But it was an example of something that was sent to me by Robert Lamb, one of the founding members of Chicago and mm-hmm. one of the principal songwriters. He's been collaborating with a gentleman named Jim Peterick, who is the, I guess Jim first came to prominence with a band called the Ides of March in the late 60s. They had one big, big hit called Vehicle.
Okay.
Also a horn band. And then Jim went on to form a band called Survivor in the 1980s.
Of course.
Who had a, wow. had a bunch of hits, you know. And Jim also, you know, co-wrote Eye of the Tiger, you know, that was used in the Rocky movie.
Mm-hmm.
And then he also wrote a lot of the hit singles for the band 38 Special.
Okay.
So him and Robert are good friends, and I actually co-wrote something with Jim this past summer that may be on the next Chicago record. We haven't finalized that set list yet. But anyway, Jim and Robert have been collaborating on a lot of different things, and they sent me that song. Most of the music was done by Robert, and Jim, I think, had more of the hand in the lyrics. And mm-hmm. Robert's a big fan of Burt Bacharach. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, Burt Bacharach's influence is pretty evident in the melody and the lyric of this song. I think it's quite reminiscent of, and as soon as I heard it, you know, I liked it very, very much. And so they sent me the tracks up here to Toronto, and I cut the vocals here, did some background vocal arranging for it. And, you know, I just, like I said, it was a bit of an insight into the process. You know, a lot of songs get written, and not all of them get on records, but I thought right. this was one that perhaps this is one that maybe somebody else at some point in time will pick up, you know, if Chicago doesn't decide to record it, or Jim himself doesn't decide to record it. It's a very good song, a very strong hook.
Absolutely. And are you, let me ask you what your creative writing process is. I know for me, I'll pick up my guitar, play a couple riffs on my phone, record it, come back to it a couple weeks later, if maybe do 20 riffs and pick one that I like and create, make it into a song. That's usually how I write songs. Usually the music comes first, the guitar part for me would come first, and the lyrics would come. Oh, and then there's sometimes I write the lyrics first and put music to it. How about you? What's your creative writing process?
Yeah, it's sort of similar for me. I tend to work usually off a lyrical idea or a title or a concept first, and then grow it out from there. Sometimes it'll just be a melody. Sometimes it will be a chord progression or a riff or something. Mm-hmm. You know, lately it's been, I've written a couple of things just recently. I'm just finishing up one with a songwriting buddy in LA, and then I have to demo something else that somebody else has written in LA that's asked me to demo for someone. And, but there's always a number of irons in the fire, you know. I find myself though, it's very curious. Mm-hmm. I'll literally be sitting down and sort of not in music creation mode, but an idea will occur to me, or I'll be walking around the house, you know, just doing, you know, mundane tasks, you know, making a bed or, you know, doing whatever you have to do.
Sure.
And an idea will pop into my head, a lyric will pop into my head, and, you know, I will grow it out from there. I really like the John Prine, the late John Prine, one of his mm-hmm. approaches, which I've used on several occasions. He'll come up with one line that he, you know, he really likes, and he'll write a whole song just so that he can sing or say that one line in the song.
Right.
And I like that approach. And Stevie Wonder is another guy who works, he works generally from a lyrical idea and works out from there. So there's, as you know, there's a lot of different ways to do it. But I guess if for me, most of the time it comes from a lyric first, a title or a lyrical idea that I want to express.
Sure, absolutely. And I know for me, I'd be sleeping and just waking up in the morning or sometime during the night when I'm sleeping, have the best song that was ever written in the world to me, and then wake up and forget what it was. Does that happen to you?
Absolutely.
It's crazy.
There was a time a few years ago when I was literally dreaming symphonies.
Amazing.
I would dream like a symphonic movement, you know.
That's crazy.
And I could wake up and sometimes I was able to retrieve little bits and pieces of it.
Sure.
But, well, you look at the way that, you know, Lennon and McCartney wrote.
Yeah.
They would have little segments of songs, a little, you know, a few lines here, a few bars here and there that they would just put aside. And at some point in time, they would stitch them together or they would find a way to stitch them together. So everything that you write, you know, you should set it aside because you don't know what kind of a gap it can fill or what kind of a glue it could potentially be for something else.
Absolutely. And let's refer to Paul McCartney in his sleep. His mother came to him. Of course, she had already passed, but his mother came to him and said, Paul, I guess he was stressed at the time, but in his sleep, his mother came to him and said, Paul, relax. Everything's going to be okay. Just let it be. And that's where Let It Be came from.
I mean, yes, I've heard that story. I mean, it's just that is the stuff that goosebumps are made of. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
The creative process is just, you know, sometimes I feel like there's just a big funnel on my head. You know, it's like things are being channeled to you sometimes, you know.
Yep, quite true. Absolutely. Yeah. Let's talk about Brass Transit. Let's talk about how long you were with them, how you got started with them, and then the transition to Chicago, because what a wonderful story.
Yeah, that was so cool. You know, I mean, a bunch of session musicians, a bunch of sort of the upper tier players in Toronto, who've always been very fond of Chicago. I mean, who very few people, musicians are, you know, always love that music. Mm-hmm. And they decided to put, a band together just to do, you know, a few gigs here and there, maybe the odd, you know, private function or whatever. just for the fun, the joy of replicating that amazing music. And when it came time to find a singer, they needed to find somebody that could ostensibly cover the three voices, you know, the Terry Kath, the Robert Lamb, and the Peter Cetera voice. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't somebody that they thought would be interested in taking the gig, I don't think, because I was a pretty busy enough, you know, with the various things in the studio and things. So the drummer of the band called me up and he asked me, you know, if I might be interested in doing it. And I thought, you know, to me, it's a challenge, you know, and I always loved the music, of course, and the challenge of being able to do all the three voices again, I sort of found interesting, and I thought, yeah, well, sure, you know. So we had a rehearsal, the band was formed, and we had a rehearsal at a rehearsal space in the west part of Toronto, and immediately, you know, within a half an hour, we all knew that there was something, you know, pretty sure. significant going on here. Everybody had, you know, shown up, you know, having done their homework as professionals. So everything just locked in very, very quickly. Of course, at the beginning, everybody was reading the music. So it took a little bit of time for everybody to get off book, you know, cause you can't do that. And literally, you know, in the early stages, we were playing a club, out in Mississauga, his name escapes me now. Just a one night, and somebody came in, somebody had a contact with a gentleman who lives, in New Jersey, who's, a multiple a Grammy award winning, producer, more in the jazz realm. Mm-hmm. His name is Joe D'Onofrio. Lovely, lovely, lovely man. And he came up and, you know, he was representing a few jazz artists here and there. And, you know, he'd never taken on what was really a tribute band, you know, and the whole tribute band thing was very hot at the time. And he loved us, right. You know, and literally a week after he heard us, he had booked us into a casino in Atlantic City. And it kind of went from there, you know. The name started to get around. The demand continued to grow. Every time the band did a gig, it was very, very well received, and we were getting more interest, you know, stateside. So we ended up doing gigs there, and people were filming the band and putting the footage up on YouTube, and, you know, it was amazing. Just kind of getting around because the music was being replicated, you know, very well. You know, we were being very respectful to these original recordings.
Sure.
And, you know, this is kind of hallowed ground to us. So that, you know, continued to circulate, and I was just having fun and, you know, not thinking much of it. And, I was apparently somebody had a copy of the DVD or something, of some footage of us. And Chicago themselves, there are a lot of different stories that are floating around about how it happened.
Right. What year Chicago, would this be? Let me interrupt. Oh, well, I'm sorry, Neil.
This would have been 2015, about 5 years ago.
Yep.
Yeah, about 5 years ago. So Chicago was, I think, playing up at a casino here in Ontario. And one of the crew guys at the casino gave the DVD to the band, you know, somebody, and somebody must have put it in, you know, the DVD player in one of the tour buses. Like the band has four tour buses.
Incredible.
And so, you know, somebody heard it, and I was unaware of this. Mm-hmm. And at some point in time, you know, some things were going to change in Chicago, and I was in New York City in December of that year, sitting in a restaurant on Broadway. I was just in New York, you know, just to see the tree lighting and catch the, you know, the lights and stuff like that. Just a little vacation. Mm-hmm. And I got an email from somebody suggesting that they were from the Chicago organization and they were trying to contact me. And at the time, literally, I thought it was somebody that was, you know, looking for work from me, you know, maybe a crew member who knew I was doing different things. And look, I'm available to do sound or lights or whatever. I thought they were literally contacting me to solicit work from me.
Mm-hmm.
So I kind of discarded it. And the next day I was out walking on the High Line. I had a conversation with somebody who at the time was a part of the, you know, the management of the band. And we had a lengthy conversation, and they told me that, you know, they were considering making changes, you know, and would I be interested in potentially, you know, working with the band. So, you know, that was sort of the beginning of it. And
amazing.
Yeah.
You let me put this into Barry words. You're playing in Brass Transit. Chicago somehow saw one of your DVDs in a tour bus and said, look at this guy sing. This guy has potential to be in our band. That's literally what happened.
Well, you know, yeah, I guess in a nutshell, it sort of is, but you know, these things have so many layers to them.
Right.
It didn't initially, my initial conversations and contact with them didn't work out that way. You know, they ended up, another gentleman ended up being in the band for a couple of years. And then that, for various reasons, ran its course. And then they contacted me, Lee Lochnane, one of the founding members and trumpet player, called me. It was in the fall, I guess it was 3 years ago now. And he said, do you want to come and sing with us? And I said, well, let me think about that.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, well, yeah, you know, and it's funny because I had done a bunch of guest appearances with the guys, you know, I'd done a few guest spots with them, three or four in various cities. And I'd gotten to know the guys, you know, I'd gotten to be friends with Lee and Robert and gotten to know them all. And I've got to tell you, not only are these, you know, really great guys, wonderful brilliant musicians, each and every
sure.
one, yep. but they are truly some of the nicest people I've ever met in my life. They're very much like family. I can't say enough about them in terms of their personalities. And, you know, even everybody that works in the band, all the, you know, the manager, Peter Civarelli, who's been the band's manager for about 40 years now, is there are just not enough accolades from me about Peter. He's a wonderful human being, an incredible manager. This guy, talk about luck having him be with the band. I mean, he really is as much a member of the band as the three founding members are, you know.
Right.
And everybody from the tour manager to the production manager, all the crew guys, these are just, I mean, there are literally about 40 people in the touring company. So, you know, you have to be a family. And everybody sure. is just, everybody's got everybody else's back and is pulling for each other. And these are just seasoned professionals who have been at the top of their game for a very long time and still are. So I feel very blessed to be a part of that family. And
sure.
So it really has to do with, you know, you first of all, you've got to have game. You've got to be able to do the job well. I mean, this is music that means a lot. These songs are milestones in people's lives.
Absolutely.
You know, you're the inspiration, Color My World, you know, Feeling Stronger Every Day. I mean, that's become an anthem for people these days. You know,
37 studio albums or more. Probably one of the biggest bands ever in the world.
Well, you know, it was it Billboard or Rolling Stone said that Chicago is the number one American band of all time, even beyond the Eagles. And that really is not about album sales. It's by virtue of the fact that the band has never missed a year touring. And even this year, you know, last year rather, we did get a little tour, and it was only the one, but it does maintain the record. We did have some dates. I think we did 11 or 12 at the beginning of the year. But they have not missed a year of touring in 52 years.
Amazing.
And and more album output, recording output than virtually any other American band. So that's why they're at the top of the list. You know, the Eagles, I think, have sold more records, but Chicago has produced more records, and they've never missed a year of touring in over 50 years, which is, you know, just, I mean, it'll never happen again. I just don't see it, you know? That's why the band is such a, has the stature that it does, you know, and it's because of Robert and Lee and Jimmy, and unfortunately Walt had to retire a few years ago for some health reasons. He's okay, but he, you know, it was just a little too much. But those three guys, you know, Robert and Lee and Jimmy, you know, they are, you know, their passion is just relentless. You know, they're just like kids when they get on stage every night.
That's amazing.
It's so inspiring, yeah.
Absolutely. And how many dates did you have set for 2020? And or sorry, 2020-21 that got canceled, of course. How many dates did you have?
Yeah, last year in 2020, we were supposed to do, I think it was about 100, it was over 100, I think it was around 110.
Amazing.
So we got in, I think it was 11 or 12. We got in our residency in Las Vegas. We did the Venetian. It was our third year in at the Venetian in Las Vegas, a 3-week residency. And then we had a show. We did one show in Arizona and one show in California. And we had, I think, two or three more shows booked in California, and that got canceled. So the last show that we did was the 13th of March in Las Vegas. Mm-hmm. And we were one of only three acts to play that night. Even though our show was sold out, only about half of the people were in the audience because, you know, it was starting
COVID,
to...
yeah.
Yeah, people were starting to get afraid. And it was us, Rod Stewart, and I think Shania Twain were the only three shows that played that night. And then we all went home the next day, so...
And that was it, shut down.
That was it, yeah.
I guess you're just itching to get back out there, probably sometime May, June, July of next year. Hopefully you guys will be back at it, yes?
Yeah, well, tentatively, we are supposed to start. I mean, you know, we're all feeling optimistic about it, depending, of course, on the vaccine rollout and things of that nature. I believe the first date we're supposed to start is the 13th of May in Oklahoma, I believe.
Amazing.
And so we've all got our fingers crossed that will come to pass. But, you know, it does remain to be seen somewhat.
Sure. And some people have gotten the vaccine. I know two people personally. You haven't gotten it yet, correct?
No. And I probably won't, you know, until the touring starts. I in this country, in Canada, you know, I'm not in a demographic or an age group that is being prioritized, of course.
Right.
So, you know, I'm a pretty healthy guy and I'm not old enough to be, you know, in that category. So I'd have to wait it out. So for me to be eligible in Canada, it'll probably be early summer, late spring. I don't know. That remains to be seen, I guess, as well. But if the touring begins in the U.S., I'm fairly certain that I will have to, I'll have to get that taken care of before I can begin that, because we would all have to be.
Absolutely, before you could tour, for sure.
Yeah,
and there'd be and actually, for me, it's the proper thing to do. I got a couple more emails here, Neil. This one's from Peter. This one's from Peter. What a range Neil has. What is his range? Also, besides voice, what other instruments does Neil play? And he says, thank you. That's from Peter.
Well, thanks, Peter. Yeah, my range is, I'm fortunate because I can cover baritone and tenor range. In my tenor range, I can sing, I can actually sing up to a high E above high C in full voice. That's not falsetto.
Amazing.
And in the bottom end of my range is more of a baritone range. It's a low F. I can hit a low F. But you know, in Chicago, because I mostly, you know, I sing all the tenor parts. I'm mostly using that range in my voice, and I do play guitar. I play a little bit in the band, not that much. Mm-hmm. And I play some keyboards and that's about it. I said, many years ago, I played trumpet and saxophone, but I haven't touched them in many years.
Sure. And so how much do you practice around the house? Are you doing the dishes? Are you vacuuming? Are you singing and practicing your voice with, you know, singing the keys, the scale, or how often do you do that?
Every day.
Good for you.
Every day. I mean, I'm doing a lot of vocal coaching. In fact, after this interview, I'll be coaching somebody online.
Cool.
So I have a bunch of clients in the U.S. that I do online coaching with, and I have a few here in Canada. So that, you know, keeps me singing every day. And I'm also doing I'm doing song demos and background vocal work for people here at home. People send me tracks, and if they want a lead vocal done or background vocals done to tracks, I'm set up to do that here at home. So I was actually doing some of that today and some of that yesterday. And I've also, you know, I'm writing here at home, I'm writing with some different people in different places. So we send the tracks back and forth, you know, and so, yeah, in some shape or form, I'm singing pretty much every day.
And it shows, man. Your voice is amazing, Neil. Why don't we go ahead and let the listener hear your voice one more time? This is a song called Either One of Us. Why don't we play that song, Neil, and discuss it after we play the song? How does that sound?
That would be great.
Excellent, folks. I have Neil Donell on the show this evening, lead singer for Chicago. This is a song of his called Either, a song that he has sang called Either One of Us, right here on Reality Radio 101.
Sad to think we're not gonna make it, and it's gotten to the point where we just can't fake it. Ooh, for some ungodly reason just won't let die. I guess neither one of us wants to be the first to say goodbye. So we just go on.
welcome back, folks. We have Neil Donell, lead singer from the band Chicago, on the show tonight. And we just listened to Either One of Us. I want to ask you, Neil, how did you come about to do that song?
Well, I've always been, for some reason, I get a great kick out of covering songs that were made hits by female singers and doing them in their key. I just think, you know, I just think it kind of gives it a different read. I've done it with a few songs. I did a version
which most guys can't do.
No,
by the way.
I sort of carved a little bit of a niche for myself in doing that. So this is just an addition. I also covered a song called "I Can't Make You Love Me," which was written by Mike Reed, and a great version from him, but was made famous by Bonnie Raitt, of course. Mm-hmm. And then there's another one called "Feels Like Home" that was written by Randy Newman, that a bunch of different people have recorded, including Chantal Kreviazuk, who is Canadian. But I did a version of that, and this one, I've always been a big Gladys Knight fan. And, you know, I love her singing, really very, very soulful. And I've always loved her songs. So I decided to be, to cover it and also be my own Pips. So I went ahead, because, you know, you got to continue to be, you know, all of us that are sort of, career musicians have had to sort of keep our chops up and continue to be creative. So I've been chipping away all year long, at releasing a new record, which I'm just, you know, kind of waiting for things for the dust to settle. So I've been written a bunch of original things, and I've also, you know, done a few cover things, and I'm about to do a couple more. I'm about to record a new original song that I've written with a friend, and also to do a cover of a Beach Boys classic called "God Only Knows."
Beautiful.
So yeah. And, you know, I put a record out, I guess it was about 2 years ago, which is available on my website. It's called Sodace, which is a combination. There's I think one original song in that, but I did a bunch of covers off of that. One of which is the Harry Nilsson song called "Without You." Oh, I can't forget this evening when your face is you leaving. You know, the big hit in that was a number one hit for Harry Nilsson, written by Pete Ham from Badfinger.
Amazing.
And there's an Elton John song on there. There's a Michael McDonald song on there. There's a Stevie Wonder song on there. So, you know, you just got to keep working. You got to keep your instrument in tune. You know, voices need to be worked. You can't take too much time off, because, you know, when we start up again, you know, it's going to be nose to the grindstone. Yeah. I mean, and, you know, I was expressing to a couple of people recently that, you know, a lot of people are going to, if they haven't kept their chops up through this, this downtime, they're going to find themselves struggling, you know, when we start back, because you do have to keep things going. You do have to continue to work and practice. And, because there's going to be, as you know, there's going to be a great hunger for live music when it all begins again. And, you know, we all want to get back out there and do what we do and bring joy to people. You know, that's why we're here. So yeah, I get a great kick out of reinterpreting, you know, other people's hits sometimes, just trying to put my own spin on them.
Sure.
And so that was what that was about.
Awesome. And to keep your chops up, that's where we go back to while you're doing the dishes, you're singing whatever, a Gladys Knight song or whatever you're singing at the time. So that's the way to keep your chops up. You don't necessarily have to take an hour out of your day to sit in your studio. You can almost do it doing anything.
Well, yeah, it's like Tony Bennett says, you know, Tony Bennett's rule of thumb, in the early going, you know, when Jason Sheff was the singer in Chicago, I met Jason about 8 years ago, and Jason and I were talking backstage, and Jason said, you know, him and Tony Bennett had a conversation on a television show, and Tony Bennett says, you know, you got to at least put in 20 minutes a day, you know,
right.
You got to, and you know, Tony Bennett was in his 80s at the time. And I told him the story about Mick Jagger, who I met, I guess about, oh gosh, it's about 20 years ago. I met Mick. I had a chat with him, and you know, he's really got his thing together. When the band was touring, he would often, you know, when you're out on tour, you go out for a few weeks and then you might have a week off, you know, or maybe you're out 3 or 4 weeks or 5 weeks, and then you've got a week off and you can get to come home for a while. So what Mick would do is he would go to his home in Barbados. He has a place in Barbados. So in the downtime, he'd fly to Barbados and he'd go have dinner. This is like during a week or two off. He'd go have dinner someplace, and then he goes back to his place where he has a full mix of the show that they're doing without the lead vocal. Because you record everything. All the bands record live off the console every night. Chicago does the same.
Wow.
So Mick takes a mix of the show down into his basement and sings the whole show and dances around.
Amazing.
Yeah. So he doesn't go, because the ramp up is so steep. And, then other guys have an approach like Joe Williams from Toto, who I had a chat with last year. We happened to sort of cross paths in Denver when we were on a night off and Toto was in doing a show. And I noticed, Joe, who was, 58 or 59, he was in fantastic voice. And so Joe and I were talking backstage, and I noticed something that Joe was doing that very few pop singers do. And Joe has learned the technique. An operatic technique that is enabling him to hit his upper register very, very strong and, without fatiguing his voice during a touring schedule. It's an operatic technique that he's using. And him and I were talking. I said, I noticed, when you get to about your A's and your B flats, I see what you're doing there. And I asked him if that was what he was doing. And he told me he had been training with an opera teacher for a couple of years in L.A.
Wow.
So it's a technique that I use, and it's a technique that Stevie Wonder uses. And what it enables you to do is, like, when you start to get in your B's and C's, in that range,
that's
a high C. That's a high C.
That's crazy.
And it's just, and that's with that technique. The key is now you have to be able to seamlessly put that technique into pop music. So you have to really know what you're doing, but it's something that I teach, certain people who are interested in learning that technique. I try to help them learn how to do that, because what that does is it strengthens your voice, and it will, my teaching technique, my coaching technique is very much focused on preservation and longevity. So that when you get like Stevie Wonder, he's like 70 years old. He's still singing in that register because he uses that technique.
Amazing that there's techniques like that you can do to keep the chops up. Now, I know, Neil, that the show is only till 8 o'clock. Gary, do you mind if we go a little longer? We're already 5 minutes past. But hey, man, this is Neil Donell.
No, absolutely. Absolutely.
Neil, I have a favorite part of my show that I ask every artist. Tell me a crazy rock star story that's happened to you, either on stage, backstage, in a hotel, out on the road. Something really crazy that's happened to you.
Something really crazy that's happened to me.
Sorry to put you on the spot. You might have to think a little bit, but I know that all the rock star artists have some great stories to tell, and it's always my favorite part of the show.
Well, I think, going back to what I mentioned earlier, like the David Foster one, it was a big one for me back then.
Sure.
And in my dealings with Chicago, I guess, there really isn't kind of a specific thing that I could talk about, but I guess what always sort of startled me is, after the show when we do the meet and greets, and somebody will come in off the meet and greet, and somebody who you greatly admire, and they'll say something really, really nice to you, or one of them. I'll tell you one.
Yes, good. Give us an example.
This is one inside the band which really took me by surprise. So I walk into the situation. First of all, I'm the first member of Chicago that's not been an American.
Right.
So
wow, isn't that something?
Yeah, the first non-American member of the band. So that in itself was somewhat of a distinction, I suppose. And
very unique.
I mean, you got to figure, you know, Walfredo Reyes, who's our brilliant drummer, who moved over from the percussion chair when Tristan Bowden left the band. Just to give you an example, when people found out that Wally was moving over to drums, Wally said that he got somewhere between 15 and 20,000 inquiries from all over the world, people who wanted to audition to be the percussionist.
Wow.
So had Chicago sort of put out like tenders, if they had gone out and went, you know, we want people to audition for the band, which has happened. I mean, I believe there's been more than just me. I mean, Judas Priest, I think, the guy that ended up fronting that band came from a tribute band of some sort. The guy who for a while replaced John Anderson when John Anderson was sick came from a tribute band in Quebec, a Yes tribute band out of Quebec.
Amazing.
But so, you know, for me to sort of be asked to do that, you know, was incredibly flattering. So, you know, people would come up to you and say really nice things to you, you know, artists of note. But I guess the one that really sticks in my mind, we were in, and I can't even tell you, it's a bit of a blur. Touring is a bit of a blur. You know, you do the show, you get in the tour bus. By the time you head off to the next city or the next venue, it's maybe 11:30. Sometimes the bus rides are only a few hours, but sometimes they're 8 or 9 hours. And you get into the next city, you know, when it's already light out and you haven't slept well because the roads are rough or something happens, you know. So it's a bit of a blur from place to place. And then you get as much sleep as you can. And then you got to get up and, you know, get something to eat and get a workout in and start to warm up. And then, you know, your lobby call is 6 p.m. and you're off to the next venue. So we were in a casino somewhere. I think it was a casino somewhere in the U.S. I don't know where. And, Jimmy Panko, who is, you know, one of the most brilliant, probably the foremost pop horn arranger in the world who's ever lived. Mm-hmm. And, you know, a guy writes stuff like, you know, Jimmy wrote Color My World. Jimmy wrote, you know, you are my love in my life. You are
amazing.
My inspiration. You know, just you and me, he wrote, you know, and
wow.
Jimmy's a great storyteller. And, you know, Jimmy is not the kind of a guy who gives out compliments freely. You know, he just doesn't do that. You know, he's very kind and very polite. And he's a lovely guy with a big heart. And after one show, I remember we were in Chicago. We were in Chicago in front, I can't remember the venue, but it was about 18,000 people in this arena, something like that. And the manager of the band, because, you know, he's the only actual member of the band, and I do call him a member, who still lives in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
He invited about 300 people of his friends, you know, everybody from Joe Theismann is a buddy of his, you know, just a who's who of, you know, Chicago celebrities were backstage. And so this, you know, this is a big deal, you know, Chicago playing in Chicago, and I'm
sure.
A new guy. And Peter invites, you know, all of his friends to show off the band, you know, their new sound or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we're in the meet and greet after, and I'm a little bit nervous. You know, there's something on the line here. The guys have kind of, you know, put it out there for me. They've taken a chance bringing this guy in, you know. So I felt there's a little pressure. There always is, you know.
Sure.
But I remember it being a very good show. I remember that. But after the show, we were in the meet and greets. And, you know, when that was over, Jimmy came up to me and he said to me, and this is the first time he had talked to me. He said, you know, I said, I've been hearing a lot of great things about you. And people are saying a lot of great things about you. You know, some people are saying you're better than Peter Cetera ever was and stuff like that, which I, you know, yeah, look, Peter Cetera is Peter Cetera. I have great respect and admiration for him. But, you know, to hear that from Jimmy,
yeah, you know, that's somebody else saying that, of course.
Yeah, and especially somebody of his stature. You know, he's a member of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. He's a member of the, him and Robert are members of the Songwriters Hall of Fame, like Lennon
Amazing.
And McCartney, like Burt Bacharach, like, you know, people of that stature, you know.
Sure.
So that's something that I'll never forget. And so a lot of the moments, you know, I remember Bill Medley coming up to me from the Righteous Brothers at, you know, at the at the Venetian after a show and saying really nice things. So when your peers, people you respect, you know, say really nice things like that to you, I mean, it really resonates because it often comes, it's unexpected. You're just kind of up there doing your job. You know, when I first started rehearsing with the band, I made it a point to go up to all of the original members individually and tell them that I wanted to thank them for their faith in me, first of all, you know, for giving mm-hmm. me the opportunity. And I said to them, you know, I really meant this sincerely, that, you know, I consider this a sacred trust.
Because, sure. Like I mentioned earlier. That's a great way to say it.
Yeah, because these songs mean so much to so many people. You know, and you are walking into some very big shoes, you know, Peter Cetera and you know, Jason Scheff. And, you know, this is, you know, a band that sold, you know, over 100 million records. And,
Amazing. You know,
it's a phenomenal position to find yourself in. And people want to hear the songs as they remember them. So, you know, you have to walk that fine line of sort of adding a little bit of yourself to it, but not so much that it's a distraction. You know, you can't get carried away with your interpretations. You have to find, you know, you have to be careful where you step out. So that's an interesting, and I've spoken to other people about this, you know. But anyway, that's a very long story. But yeah, you know, when you get compliments from anybody that you respect or, you know, good feedback, you know, that's the stuff that really resonates and really impacts you. That being said, you know, I do know a couple of other great stories. I know a great story about Paul McCartney, and I know a great story about David Coverdale and Whitesnake, but perhaps that's for another.
Okay, hold on. Gary, how long can we go? Because Paul McCartney is my utmost, most favorite artist of all time is Paul McCartney. Gary, how long can we go?
You can go till, I would say, max around 8:30.
Love it. Carry on, Neil. This is going to be our longest show, man.
Now this is a story that I heard, but you know, there's, you know, I got my first chance to see Sir Paul only about 5 or 6 years ago. I was in Orlando doing a show. I had a night off, and I managed to get in. He had added a second show at the Acme Center there, and I got in to see him. I lasted three songs before the tears started to run down my face. You know, I think it was, "She gives me everything."
Oh my God.
I lost it. That was it.
Absolutely.
But the story I heard, you know, there was a lot of stories circulating about Paul McCartney, you know, about his relationship with different band members. And some of them were not terribly flattering. Everybody, and these stories, you know, nobody can say whether or not they're true or not, but I heard this one. And I'll tell you the version that I heard of it. And this is actually, I think, who he is. Somebody in the band Wings, who he had lost contact with for a very long time, he ran into this person somewhere in New York a bunch of years ago. And he actually, you know, I said, you know, where have you been, man? I haven't seen you. What's become of you? I didn't know where you were and all that, you know, and the guy said, well, you know, I guess he sort of said, well, you know, I was kind of bummed out by the way this all worked out, you know, with, you know, the record, you know, the live Wings Over America thing and all the stuff that I played on, or, the different TV shows or specials or whatever, the DVDs that I was in. You know, I never got paid for any of that stuff, and I just kind of got bummed out by it all, and I got tired of chasing it, you know. And apparently McCartney was oblivious to this. He had no idea that this had happened. Mm-hmm. So he goes and he makes he's kind of peed off at it, you know. And he goes and he makes a few phone calls, and within very short period of time, this guy gets a check for, you know, he got compensated, and it was in the seven figures.
Wow.
Yeah. So McCartney went out of his way to make sure that this got corrected.
That's amazing.
Yeah. I mean, there are really great people in the business. You know, you hear a lot of bad stories, but sure, when you hear some great stories, I mean, Another one, I'm going to tell you a sort of a Canadian story that I don't know if you know this one or not, but this is a story that I always like to tell people. There's a few, but this one is about Shirley Eichardt.
Uh-huh.
And Shirley, a lot of people don't know, Shirley had her career started very young on a sing-along Jubilee a long time ago, in the 60s, really, when she was a kid. And she became, she had a bit of a career as a recording artist, but she was also, very committed and a fairly prolific songwriter. And so Shirley was living somewhere north of Toronto, and she comes home one day, and this is back in the day of the answering machine with the little blinking red light. And the light is blinking, and she had a publisher, a very good publisher here in Toronto, a very respected man named Frank Davies, I believe is her publisher. And, Shirley would write tunes, and Frank would shop them around. And like other people, you don't necessarily know where your songs are going. You just write them and you give them to the publisher, and the publisher hears an artist looking for songs and sends them to them. So sure. Shirley sees the answering machine blinking, and she pushes it, and the voice comes on and says, "Oh, hi, Shirley. This is Bonnie Raitt. I just recorded your song."
Wow.
And Bonnie holds, the phone up to the playback speakers, and Shirley is, "Let's give him something to talk about." She hears that. And Shirley had no idea that Bonnie Raitt had recorded the song. And I add a little thing on that's really fictitious, but I always say that then one of the neighbors had to come over with a giant spatula to scrape Shirley off of the ceiling.
Oh, can you imagine something like that happening?
It was a career making song, and the consensus is, the beautiful part about that story is, it could not happen to a nicer, more talented person.
That's great.
So sometimes the cream rises, and sometimes the people who really deserve it, get success. And Shirley is just like one of the, the nicest, kindest, most talented people you could ever meet. And, when I hear stories like that, it's the same story that happened to Alfie Zappacosta and Marco Luciani with the same music publisher who got a track on the Dirty Dancing soundtrack.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Amazing. I can't tell you the name of the song, but how big that soundtrack was.
It sold
millions and millions. So it's the kind of a song that probably, made them financially comfortable for the rest of their lives.
Absolutely.
And in Shirley's case, writing a song of that stature would open all kinds of doors to other songwriters. Like other songwriters, were probably clamoring to write with her at that point in time, because it's quite the calling card.
Oh, no kidding. And just let me say, Neil, that I have 50 originals out there on the internet, so please pick one and sing it with Chicago. Now, Neil, I there's a segment of a show that I do, my friend. First of all, I want to say thank you for building the house that we all grew up in. You've had a lavish, beautiful musical career. You're the lead singer for Chicago now. It's an absolute honor to have you on the show and talk to you. But there's a segment of the show that I like to do called, "Well, Gary, what do you think?"
Wow, what do I think? Well, where do I
Holy
start?
Smokes.
How much time do I have? Okay. Well, thank you, Neil. First of all, I've been a big Chicago fan. I grew up with Chicago. I started listening to them in junior high school in 1970.
In
New York. And I remember I'm a Man coming out. I remember hearing that on the radio on a top 40 station. And I said, who the hell are these guys? And I was about 13 years old or 14 at the time. And I couldn't believe it. And I just started listening to more and more and more. And I said, these are guys in a band. When things at that time were British Invasion, kind of, a lot of heavy stuff, crunchy stuff. These guys are playing instruments. They're combining rock with jazz, stuff. They know their instruments. They're sophisticated musicians. The melodies are amazing. I was hooked. And Chicago has been one of my favorite bands throughout my life, in my 60s now. And I just said, it's incredible. So it's an honor to talk to you. I love your vocal range as well. And, you know, as you know, we get up in years, it's a little bit harder to hit those notes, especially when you're on a tour and live every night, you know. But, yeah. You know, I'm hoping you take care of yourself and you stay well. And I wish you, you and the band, nothing but the best again in 2021.
Thanks, Gary. I really appreciate that.
You're welcome.
Good. And so when you get back playing, now I think all your dates you have coming up, Neil, are mostly in the States, correct?
Yeah.
Let me cut you off. I'm sorry. Let me ask you this. Do you have any Canadian dates set?
Right now, from what I can tell, no. You know, once things get started in May, hopefully, that's the game plan, they will continue to add dates. Right now, it looks as if we have about 50 confirmed dates for 2021, right from May into early December. And typically what we'll get, when I get my itinerary, when I get my tour schedule, it will say, you know, to be filled. So I think as places open up, you know, more dates will be added. In 2020, there was only one Canadian date, on that skid. And that was here in Toronto. We're supposed to, I think it was beginning of August. Mm-hmm. So I'm quite sure that, but you know, people are now clamoring because, I'll just drop you a little possibility. There is a rumor circulating that the next tour that the band does may again be with Earth, Wind and Fire.
Beautiful.
So that will be a gigantic tour. And mm-hmm. I know there are countries all over the world clamoring, you know, Australia and Germany and all over Europe. And everybody wants the band to go over there and all through the Pacific Rim. So, you know, there's only so many days in a year. So it remains to see how it's all going to play out. But,
of course,
you know, the band is not going to go out with a whimper. When we come back, we're going to come roaring back. Trust me, roaring back. Everybody is just champing at the bit, you know, to get going again. So as it stands right now, there isn't a Canadian show, but I'm quite sure that there will be at some point.
Absolutely. And, you know, you'll be better than ever because everyone's going to be so pumped. Let me just tell you that if there is a Canadian show, please send me a text. So my wife and I are concert freaks. We go to everything. My wife and I will come down and see you guys. That would be awesome. Just send me a text if you remember that you have a concert somewhere in Canada, hopefully Toronto, and we'll come see you. Another thing I wanted to say is 350 million people in the States, 35 million people in Canada, and you are the only Canadian that's ever been in the band Chicago. I mean, that alone in itself is like winning the lottery.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's a great blessing and a great gift. And it's like you said earlier in the show, it's very curious. I find myself in this place. You know, my father passed away about 12 years ago, never having heard me perform live. And my mother died when I was on tour last year, unfortunately, and I couldn't get back to see her in time. And she had only ever heard me sing live on one occasion. So there is no music in my family. You know, I was never really encouraged to do this. So the mere fact that this is sort of where I landed is, I can only say that I believe that there's some kind of a divine intervention going on here. And this is why I'm here. So I believe that, if you're fortunate enough to find what your gift is, and everybody has one, then it's up to you to honor it and do something with it. And that's all I'm trying to do is honor it and bring beautiful music to people and hopefully give them something to take them away from the trials and tribulations of their lives, even for a couple of hours, if they can feel some kind of joy. You know, that's our job.
Absolutely. And you know what? It's well deserved. You are where you're at because of how good you are. And that's just plain and simple. There's no other ins and outs about it. Sure, it's people you know. Sure, it has to do with Brass Transit. But you are where you're at because of how good you are. So never, you know, always think that. You're just a great singer. And there's more to it, of course, than just singing. You have to be tardy and prompt and have everything together. But, you know, they choose you for a reason and it seems to be working well. Neil, we have to say goodbye, my man. What can I say? It's been an absolute honor to have you on the show. We're going to follow your progress. If you come out with a solo album or something with Chicago, we'll get you back on the show in a year or two from now and follow your progress. And I appreciate you being here. Thank you kindly.
Thank you. And if people want to see what I'm up to, they can go to my website at neildonell.com. And there's a record there if they want to have a listen to some samples, and they can always order it. And I appreciate your time. It was great fun talking to you.
Yeah, and you as well, folks. There you go. Please go buy some Neil Donell stuff online. He's got some great music. Fabulous singer, one of the best in the world. Thank you again, Neil. And to the listener, I say thank you for being here. And always dance and sing. Let the music bring your soul to the surface for all the world to see. Until next time, have a shuffle your feet kind of week, and good night. You've been listening to This House of Musicians on Reality Radio 101.